Hi again.
Hey, again.
I kind of expected you to like have a beard by this point, or lose the mustache, or a whole different look. Are you working on that with that mustache, or are you? Is it
working
just
on being sexy with a mustache? I mean, you just working it.
You can't help yourself.
No, it's I'm shooting a miniseries in Yonkers. It's late '80s, early '90s, and the character is a guy that actually playing a real person. Mm-hmm. Based on a real person, and he had the stash.
He had the stash. Mm-hmm. Though I think JC made fun of it. It was cruel and unusual.
Yeah, people get offended by mustaches a lot.
It's incomprehensible, considering how hot beards are at the moment, particularly in that neighborhood.
Yeah, it's just arbitrary, you know, it's fashion.
Were you ever a hipster? Did you ever want to be a hipster when you grew up?
What's a hipster?
A hipster? What is a hipster?
Yeah.
I don't know, a guy from Brooklyn these days. You know, well, everybody has them.
I'm from
beards.
Brooklyn, and I have a mustache.
And your mustache does that make you a hipster?
Yeah. Oh well.
Are you from Brooklyn?
No. I'm living there now.
You're living there now. Where were you actually born?
I'm hipstering there now. I was born in Guatemala.
Hipstering since 2017. So how long did it take you to get over the water?
To get over the water.
When did you come? Fine country?
I was five. My family came when I was 5 months old to Baltimore, and then from Baltimore to Louisiana, and then Louisiana to South Florida, and then there for quite a while until I came to New York for school.
And see, it's funny. Ever since. You and I don't think I knew you had the Miami part of it, but I'm actually from Baltimore also.
Oh yeah.
So yeah, we're the same trajectory except for the Guatemala part.
That was the first place. That's the first place we came.
Yeah, I'm from Pikesville.
My dad grew up in D.C.
So. It's a tiny little world.
Mm-hmm.
So how are things going?
They're well. Yeah, going well.
Are you enjoying this kind of love fest around this movie?
Yeah, it's great. I mean, it was a labor of love, and the fact that people are responding well to it, it's great. It's a great feeling.
You're kind of going into the post-labor of love era of your career. It feels like you're now going to be doing big, giant movies as well as the small movies.
Well, yeah, as well. Yeah, yeah. Still labors of love as well, but...
Does it feel the same?
I guess
you've already shot the Star Wars.
Yeah. Well, the actual work, you know, between action and cut is exactly the same. But you know, I guess the machinery behind it is definitely bigger.
Is the decision making about doing it the same?
It's like is it a character that I'm interested in playing? What can I do with it? Will it keep my interest? Does it pique my curiosity? Is it a place that I want to? Is it a life that I want to live in for however long amount of time? Yeah, those are all still the same considerations.
So does the insanity around something as big as Star Wars spin your head, or do you just kind of...
It's a little bit. I think even subconsciously, I mean, the pressure of it, it's very hard to compartmentalize that. But again, you know, it's... So it just takes maybe a little bit of extra energy to try to, you know, push that stuff to the side and just focus on what's in your control, which is between action and cut.
You know? And do you do... I mean, is it a green experience for you? I assume that X-Men will be more of one...
Green screen? I'm not sure. I don't know how. Yeah, the way that X-Men works.
Right.
But with Star Wars, it was. I mean, there was so much of it was there. You know, so much of it is was practical sets, tactile things that you can hold and you can see and you can look out and I just think that infuses everything with a sense of reality and also it holds up better. Mm. I think that the movies that really make the stuff that's practical, it's there, I think those movies tend to hold up better than the ones that just rely on whatever the best technology is of the moment for computer-generated effects. Mm-hmm. I mean, they've come a long way. They're amazing. But I still think there's no comparison to the actual craftsmanship of a three-dimensional thing right in front of you.
Did you grow up with those kind of movies? Did you grow up a fan of those kind of movies?
Of Star Wars?
Star Wars, Raiders, all those, you know, big action movies.
It was big, yeah, loved those movies. Return of the Jedi was the first one I remember seeing, first movie I remember seeing in the theater.
Huh.
Yeah.
Had you seen the other two movies?
When I saw Return of the Jedi, that's the first movie I remember seeing in a movie theater, so I don't know, I was pretty young, so, because I was, 81 or 2?
I think 82, right? Yeah.
for the last one. So yeah, I was like 3 or 4 years old.
Because we were asking, we were asking people about their first movie experience, actually, and Star Wars and Empire came up, but people don't remember whether they saw which one first.
Which one first? Yeah,
because they saw them all on VHS.
Yeah, yeah.
No, I'm so young. You
know? That must have been the first one that I saw. I think Return of the Jedi. Yeah.
So, were you a fan of movies that were more like A Most Violent Year? Or did it take?
Not when I was three. Yeah, not when I was three. But yeah, once I.
Your parents didn't take you to Kramer versus Kramer, ordinary people?
No. No, but I did start seeing, I remember I was, how old was I? I must have been 10. I don't know why my dad did this, but I'd heard him talking about it, but then he's like, don't see Deer Hunter. And like literally the next thing I did was go to the video store and get Deer Hunter. and watch it. So I watched that one pretty young and I was like, what? Yeah, I've watched a lot of really intense movies accidentally. I remember me and my friend, I was in sixth grade, and me and my friend went to the movie theater, and we saw a poster with this naked woman on her side, and the movie was called Boxing Elena. And we're like, yeah, let's go sneak into this movie. There's definitely gonna be boobs in it. And so we like bought a ticket to I don't know what, and like Batman or something, which was around at the same time, and then snuck in, and we're like, yes. And then it started, and we're like, what the fuck is this? Because then, like, they start cutting her arms off and her legs, and it was very freaky. So that's happened a few times, but yeah. So I was really into those movies when I was a kid. Jacob's Ladder was another one that I was really into, and then I was a big Van Damme guy.
You loved Van Damme?
I loved Van Damme.
You know, he's still very, very popular. Certain countries where he's still like the top
boxer. JCVD, that was a great movie. I thought he was great in that too. But yeah, I was like big into Bloodsport and Kickboxer. And
where they're doing Cyborg, a remake of Kickboxer, Cyborg, apparently, with him as...
I'll be there. What I started doing. So when I first started making movies, it would just be like karate movies, you know.
Did you ever learn to do karate?
A little bit. I got really close to being able to do the straddle that he does when I was a kid.
They're probably not between two trucks.
Okay. No.
So when was there a time where you got into more serious, you know, into Lumet and into the kind of filmmakers that are progenitors of this film?
Yeah. Well, then, I mean, I started really, getting into those, you know, something more serious films and The Mission being one that I remember really kind of blowing my mind. And then when I got into high school and I, you know, first saw Dog Day Afternoon, you know, and that became just my Bible. You know, I loved that movie, so I've seen that movie. That's the movie I've probably seen the most. Mm-hmm. The Fugitive Kind and 12 Angry Men and all. Yeah, I really fell in love with Sidney Lumet's movies. And then the films from the 70s, you know.
So did you want to be Pacino, or did you just like the whole vibe?
I just loved the vibe of it. And what I loved the most is that it felt like this guy he has no idea there's a camera on him. That's what it felt like. It felt like, you know, and Charles Durning in that movie, it's an incredible performance. And John Cazale and Chris Sarandon, I mean, they're just, the whole thing, and the tellers, everything about it. There's no music in the whole thing, except for the Elton John song in the beginning. Just the pace of it, the feel of it, everything about it, I just thought this is unlike anything that exists that I've ever even seen. And really loved that. And The Conversation and Midnight Cowboy and all those movies, you know, I really fell in love with those.
So have you seen The Dog?
The Dog?
Yeah, there's a documentary called The Dog.
Oh, yes, I did, about Sonny. About the actual guy, yeah. It was great.
It was kind of amazing.
Yeah, it was great, yeah.
A perfect double feature.
Yeah.
So what was the spark that made you want to actually start acting?
Well, I was not the star. I would be the villain in most of my karate movies.
With a mustache.
couldn't grow the mustache at the time. But so we would just act in them. Huh. And I don't know. I was in a play in fifth grade and I liked that, and I started.
Which play?
It was one that I wrote about Noah's Ark.
Wow, better than Noah or the same?
Well, it focused on a platypus on Noah's Ark, so it was a little bit different.
Okay.
A little bit different. And there was a rapping alligator as well. Of course. course.
A play of its time.
Yeah.
Clearly.
Yeah. And so, I don't know, I just gravitated towards it. I don't know how it happened or why necessarily. It just, it's just something that I just started doing, and I loved doing it, and I was getting more opportunities to do it. And then that also happened with music at the same time when I got into high school, and I kept doing both of those things simultaneously. And the first, I don't know, I guess it wasn't the first, but one of the first paying jobs I got was acting in something. So, yeah.
So was it the attention? Was it the craft itself? Was it, did you even think about craft at that point?
Well, when I was in fifth grade, I don't think I thought about craft, but I think I think there was a need to express. There was just a express like feelings and what it felt like to be experiencing what I was experiencing, even as a kid, you know, and understand what was happening emotionally, and then express that to other people, and then you know, you do a play, and then you know, there is a sense of, you know, your individuality is being thrown out there, and especially for me. I mean, I'd fluctuate between introvert and extrovert, but you know, and also, you know, if any issues would happen at home, that was like a way of funneling that stuff out. So yeah, I think it came more from that place.
And did you ever start studying at some point in a serious way?
Not until after high school, really. I mean, in high school, I started reading Shakespeare a little bit, and I really started liking that. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't until I got out of high school, and I started doing theater in Miami a little bit. Mm-hmm. And so then I would start reading acting books a little bit more, and I was wanting to get better, and then doing some interesting plays down there. I remember I did This Is Our Youth, which was a great Kenneth Lonergan play that it's on Broadway right now. Yeah, it was amazing because I went to go see it. They were so good. Yeah. And I remembered all the lines too. I was like, I could say it with it, and that's, you know, that was what, 97 or 98 or something when I did that. So yeah, and then went to Juilliard, and that's when, you know, it became definitely so much about the craft and creating a process and figuring out what your process is and creating a character, and I was able to actually finally articulate a lot of what was just up until then subconscious and instinctual.
So is part of the structure there to let you figure out your process, or are they kind of picking a process that you connect to?
No, you go there because they have, it's not like, here's a buffet of different processes, which one is good for you, which is actually what it ultimately is, because when you leave there, you have to figure out, well, what am I going to keep? What am I going to do? What am I going to stay on top of? But no, they have they have their way of how you approach a play, and you know, this is, you know, according to this teacher, this is what you do. These are other tools. You know, it's a lot about tools. What are different tools to get, not necessarily the results you want, but tools to explore and to create. You know, whether it's vocal work and dialect work, and how you break down a scene, how you break down a character, how you find the spine, how you find the arc of a thing. You know, how do you get yourself to places emotionally that you need to get to? Different things like that, and then studying the classics.
Because, like at NYU, people go to school at NYU, and then it's basically farm them out to the schools around New York.
Oh yeah. Like,
so some people go to HB, and some people go to the actors.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
So yeah, then, you know, there's no real singular voice out of NYU.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's interesting. I mean. You know, I guess the idea that Juilliard was focused so much on classics, you know, and its repertory, I think those aspects are probably what gave Juilliard a little bit more of its voice. You know, there was maybe a highly disciplined aspect to it, which I think some people didn't like. Some people felt like it was a little too robotic. And so the balance was, what do you take on as just a helpful tool, and then what can I leave behind? Because, you know, it was a little bit about breaking you down and building you up into the actor we want you to be. And the fact that I think I had a little bit of experience doing theater before I didn't go straight from high school, that allowed me to be like, oh, that's kind of bullshit. Oh, that's good. That's really good, you know. Because they would try to get in there psychologically.
So you were already had enough weight as an adult.
Yeah, enough to be like, they're just trying to get to me, and not to take it too personally. Although I was looking at my journal not too long ago, and I was like, it literally one day it would be like, I figured it out. Oh my gosh, I know what acting is about. And the next day I would be like, I'm quitting. I hate this. I don't know what I'm doing here. And it was very up and down.
So do you feel like you figured it out now?
No. That's the whole point. I mean, you can't. You never figure it out. If you do, I think you're done. And the thing is, how do you figure out staying curious and keeping your, you know, feeding your curiosity? And that's the most important thing, because once that goes away, then I think you get a little lazy, and you know, when you're like, oh, I know how to do this, then you take it for granted. But staying curious and continuing to dig and try to find it and find this, and all right, well, what's not quite right, or this is right, or what can it be, what's possible.
So do you watch your performances? Much?
Yeah, I'll see. I'll watch them.
Do you break them down? I mean, do you
not really. I can. I can't really see something more than two times, because I'm not objective, and it's weird. It's difficult.
Yeah.
Yeah, because even if it's a great experience, and if I see something and maybe it didn't come out the way that I thought it was going to come out, then it can kind of ruin it a little bit. So in some ways I'd rather just remember it, and you know, and again, it's also a way to not become so result oriented, you know, to know that when you do it, it's about the process of doing it as opposed to what it's going to be like. But I imagine that with some people, they can have enough discipline to be able to see it and not make it all about that either, you know?
What's interesting, it seems like there's some actors we talk to who have a find something that distracts them, like they're, you know, they get involved on the producing side, or they get involved with something, so they kind of have to disconnect emotionally from them on the screen as much.
Yeah.
So there's a way around it, but a lot of it's a fascinating thing, because there's definitely that the excitement and the thrill of having done something and the work having been a great experience, and then all of this stuff, and then, you know, what the numbers are and all that kind of stuff can actually, like, you know, piss on the parade.
Yeah, a little bit, yeah. Sure. But, it, you know,
or
it's
make
also
it overly, you know, positive.
Yeah, yeah, parade. Yeah. But, it, you know, it is interesting to see how the cumulative effect of everything you've done and everything, you know, this group of people have made together, how that works on people and what people pick up. And though that is really interesting, because there's things, again, you know, it's about capturing the subconscious, you know, it's bottling it for a moment. I think that's the idea, and when you do that, it allows other people's subconscious feelings and thoughts and all these things to come to the surface, and to hear what gets triggered in people. It's interesting. It can be very rewarding.
So when you get a script like this, are you thinking about how painful it's going to be to get through this experience, or is it the challenge
to get through the experience of shooting it,
of actually going to the places you have to go with the character emotionally?
No. For me, it's you know, you kind of just try to read it without putting myself in it right away, because if you do, then already I'm thinking about how am I going to do, as opposed to like what am I even seeing here? And so you just try to see what's coming out from what you're reading. And then, is that interesting to me? Is that someplace that I want to live in a little more? And then I'll read it again a little bit more, as like, okay, now who is this guy? And then is that a, you know, it's like a meditation on a life, and it's a meditation on themes, and it's a meditation on whatever this writer has put together. And it's like, do I want to live in that state of mind for 3, 4, 5 months? Is there something that I want to explore about myself in that? And you know, and sometimes it's a little less calculated. It's just, it's like falling in love. You can't really explain why, but I just can't stop thinking about it. I don't know why, but it's constantly not far from my head. And you know, I'm already in that world, even if I, you know, I don't have to try hard to imagine myself there. I'm already there. So it's hard to explain.
So is there something you fell in love with Abel?
No. No, this one was different. This one was different because it was very dense, the script. And JC has a very broad mind, and it was a long script. I can't remember exactly how many pages it was, but you know, a lot's been cut. And I'm not interested in business at all. I'm bad with money. It's about heating oil.
Everybody's favorite subject.
That party topic. And it was very formal, and the guy was very formal and a bit of a square, and so everything about it was like, what am I getting? Do I want to live in the world of heating oil in 1981? You know, it wasn't easy. But at the same time, there was something completely subconscious that I didn't understand at all that I found moving. There was like something about it that moved me, even though the things around it were very hazy. And then I would try to talk to JC about it, and he didn't make it any easier.
Because it just got more complicated.
Because you've talked to JC.
Yeah, the bullet train.
He's like, he's, you know, talking about all sorts of stuff, and his hair and his costume and the suits and this. And I was just like, what? I don't understand what this is, but I recognize. And Jessica was like, oh my gosh, this is you. And I'm like, all right, I'm glad you feel that way, because I'm having a hard time. And so it was a slow courting of what it was, and me trying to figure it out, and in some ways feeling like I was on my own to do that. And JC, ultimately, that was purposefully so, because JC didn't want to just lay it all out. He wanted me to arrive at it. And so as I kept reading it and kind of figuring out who this was formally, and being like, right, well, what's happening emotionally? What is he feeling? You know, what are the themes? Ambition and the idea of having a strategy that's like a long-term strategy, that it's unshakable, and kind of the sociopathic tendency that you need to be able to be that focused on a goal where everything else you can let it fall to the side. And what is this relationship with this woman, and what do I want to explore about relationships between, you know, men and women, and how that can work, and what are partners that want to take over the world, and you know, all those, the more emotional sides of it, mm-hmm. suddenly became very interesting to me. And and also ideas and thoughts about my grandfather and archetypal male figures, and the idea of power, you know, all those things began to surface and made me fall in love with it.
Mm. So grandpa was powerful and quiet?
I think everybody feels like their grandpa is kind of like that. There's something that's, yeah, it's like the patriarch, you know, and you know, my father was, he was a quiet guy, and he had a mechanics shop, a garage in Guatemala, but he was very tender-hearted, very sweet man. But yeah, there's just something, I don't know, there was something about the memory or the feeling of what it's like to think about when your grandfather was young that I think infused a little bit of this. I think that's where some of the formality comes from, and particularly when I would see him, you know, interact with strangers and what's presented, and there's just like this very old school vibe to him, and I think that was a fun thing to explore with Abel.
Well, Abel definitely has like a combination of both Michael and Vito Corleone. It's like he has that formality that Vito had of, you know, never let anybody see past the family.
Yeah,
and he also has Michael's, you know, kind of but anxious, you know, looking, wants to move forward, but sees all the traps also.
Yeah.
But he actually doesn't see all the traps in this case, I guess. Abel is kind of, as you say, has blinders on.
Yeah.
Most of the time.
Yeah. Yeah. Or he's choosing not to acknowledge those traps and not to play that game. You know, he wants to play his game, and he doesn't want to, basically lower himself to what everyone else wants him to do, you know. I think his sights are set so much higher, and that's the image that JC started with, which is this guy in this beautiful, immaculately tailored suit in this little shitty trailer, putting everything on the line to grow. And what's that about? And that's a compelling idea, you know. Someone who sees themselves, sees the thing that they want to be. And is already trying to be it, even though everything around them says, that's not you, buddy, that's not you, you're us, you're one of us, you know, even his wife.
Well, this is the moment he really becomes the patriarch, even though he already has kids, he has a nice house,
exactly, yeah.
But this is the step to being
yeah,
the godfather, for lack of a better term.
Well, or just a real player, and yeah. a political one, not a gangster, you know.
Right. Well, one of the five families, the cleaned up version.
Yeah.
Yeah. I didn't nearly mean to make all these analogies to Godfather. I'm sorry. I just kind of, it's occurring to me as you're talking about it. It actually is connecting.
Well, it's a big, yeah. I mean, we don't have royalty, you know. We don't, one of the books that I read was the Memoirs of Hadrian, which is all about, it's Margaret Usener, but she writes it as Hadrian writing letters to Marcus Aurelius, who's going, you know, as he's dying. And he recounts his rise, you know, the story being ambition to mastery to exaltation to the fall, basically, mm-hmm. and then a reconciliation. And that is, you know, the story of power and the story of trying to rise in this world. And so we don't have kings and queens and emperors and all that. You know, we have different stories. We have the capitalist story, and in all its forms, in the dark forms, because ultimately that's what the, you know, gangsterism and all that. That's just about mm-hmm. making a buck, you know.
It is.
And then this one is a similar thing, but trying to do it the right way,
mm-hmm.
or the most right way.
What's that moment where you find out whether or not who really wants it?
Yeah,
I always think that's the thing. Is like a lot of people aspire. But and some of them get closer, but at the point where you really have to like get down and dirty and get there, is, and this movie is really that moment. It's the whole movie is that moment.
Yeah. What are you willing to do?
Yeah.
Is
your will strong enough to
withstand
yeah.
Everything that it takes to get there? Yeah, absolutely. And so, you know, and the balance between playing somebody that's having to be so strong in spite of everything that's going on, but at the same time completely emotionally invested in everything that's happening. That was a very fun thing to play with. Mm. The way that, you know, when that would release, when it would release too much between what he's trying to project and what he can't help but project.
Mm. And what he doesn't want to project.
Yeah, exactly. Can't help, you know, it slips out because that's who he is and he's just a human.
Well, that's the balance of the wife, the Jessica's character is, you know, because she's kind of like always pulling him to a weird place that
yeah.
he doesn't want to go.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, she's definitely willing to do things that he doesn't want to do or doesn't even want to acknowledge.
Yeah.
You know, she's cut from a different cloth, but the fact that the two of them still are able to find a way to succeed together is impressive.
Well, she's one of the choices, I guess,
along yeah.
the way.
Yeah.
So is when you do a movie like this and it's so intensive, is the experience of the months, of the days, hard? Or is it, do you let it go when you get off set? And
well, no, it stays with you, like I said, because you're kind of meditating on it all the time.
Yeah.
So it sticks around. So yeah, it definitely, it was a heavy time, you know? I mean, I don't purposefully think about it all the time, but you know, it's also, it's fun, and you're problem solving constantly, because you know mm-hmm. you know that you're doing the scene the following day, or even if it's the weekend, you know, you've got these scenes coming up the next week, and you know you're still trying to understand it and find your way through emotionally, and you know there's so much possibility because it can be anything, so you don't want that to go away completely.
Right.
So you know you want to be always a little bit, you want it to be readily available.
You have scenes you get more nervous about that are, you know, are coming in a day or two, or is it all similar?
Sure. If there's a certain scene that's complex and I feel like I haven't really cracked it mentally yet, you know, that can definitely give a little anxiety to be like, I hope I can figure out at least just the right approach to it when the day comes. But you know, no matter how much preparation you do, ultimately when the camera starts, you do have to just really let it all go and see what sticks. Mm. And the hope is that stuff will stick around, you know. But you know, the most important thing is never to try to, at least for me, communicate too much.
Right.
You know, you just keep it expressive. You just let whatever comes out come out as it's happening. And the idea of homework is that will have guided you to, you know, a series of options that will be within this framework that you've been meditating on. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And when you rap, does it instantly slide away, or does it take you a while to?
A little bit, but yeah, I usually do something pretty drastic quickly to try to get out of it, mm-hmm. like shave the mustache right away, or like my head, or do something that mm-hmm. that you know that you let it go. But even still, I mean, I can be in the shower and be like, "That's what that scene was with Llewyn Davis." I should have, you know, that still happens a lot.
like a stroke or something.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What is it? Dimensional or demented bingo or demented. Scrabble or something. So do you, I mean, and are you at a point yet where you look back much? I mean, is there perspective on work that you did 2 or 3 years ago at this point? Or is it still so kind of in the midst of becoming whatever Oscar Isaac capital letters is going to be?
Well, yeah, again, I hope that it's never like, oh, that's what that is. That's what his acting is or whatever, you know?
Well, it's an interesting thing because there's that whole thing about movie stars where there's a connection, there is something about a person that on film, you know, either that person is connected to the audiences or not. It's like, you know, you can, character actors have a way of slipping in and out of characters, but you're playing these, you know, strong leads at this point. And so there is a personal relationship, I think, that people feel they have with you. Mm-hmm. But it's not, there's, you know what I mean? So there's like, you're doing things that are very different, and yet there's something about Oscar that has to connect with people for you to be a star.
Okay. I mean, that's not something that you can, I mean, how do you, what do you, like, control that? Or, you know, it's like, all I can do is just focus on, like, the character, right? And the work, and then, you know, exploring who I am through the character. And hopefully what people really see is themselves, you know? I mean, I think that's ultimately the idea, is that you, if you just see and you try not to push your agenda onto people too much, whatever that may be, like, I'm charming, I'm funny, I'm angry, I'm intense, I'm whatever it is. Mm-hmm. If that falls away and you really just live in that meditation, whatever that is, mm-hmm. I think when it really connects is when people actually start seeing themselves or recognizing just the, like, oh, that's similar to my experience, or I know what that experience is. Oh, actually, we think similarly. You know, I think it's one of the only times, it's one of the only tools we have to really feel like, oh, we do think the same. Mm. Because otherwise, there's really no way that I could ever express to you, you know, when I drink a little bit of Red Bull, what, you know, I can describe it, but there's no way for me to know if your experience of it is anything like mine. It could be completely alien. Mm. And yet, I think through art in general, that's one of the few things that allows us to be like, oh, no, we see things the same way. That's why, like, those cave paintings in where is it? The Cave of Forgotten Dreams in France. Yeah, mm-hmm. Did you see that, Werner Herzog?
Yeah.
It was terrifying. Because you see that, and you're like, it was 40,000 years ago, and you're like, you see the world exactly the same way. Nothing's really changed, and, you know, you feel like you evolved so much, but, you know, same shit, different cave.
I think that says it all. Thank you so much. All right, man.